This is our daily briefing for Mauna Loa's current volcanic activity for Wednesday, November 30th, 2022. So I'm Steve Sobieszczyk. I'm a public affairs specialist with the USGS, and I will be moderating today's call. It looks like we have more people than we did yesterday, so some reminders, some housekeeping, just to make sure that this session goes as smooth as possible with the virtual environment. We're scheduled for 30 minutes. We're going to try keeping the briefing brief so folks can go on about their days. The meeting is being recorded and it's being transcribed. We do have closed captioning going on below if you guys want to read along, if you can't actually hear for some reason, with your audio, that is, sorry. We will begin with updates from our presenters before opening up the floor to questions. To save bandwidth once again, cameras off, muted where possible. If you're logged on to Teams and you do have a question, please press the raise hand button when you're ready. And we'll go through the different questions one by one in order. For those who are calling in, I will pop in every so often and kind of call out your area code phone number to have see if you have any questions to ask. So please be as specific as possible when you're addressing your questions, pointed to a specific person. Try to be concise so that we all have as many questions as possible during our presser today. And if you run out of time or if you have a follow-up question, please feel free to email us at volcanomedia@usgs.gov. So volcanomedia@usgs.gov, and we'll make sure to find someone to give you an answer. I am pleased to introduce today's presenters. We'll be joined by Ken Han from the USGS Hawaiian Volcano Observatory, Talmadge Magno from Hawaii County Civil Defense, and Jessica Farrakane from Hawaii Volcanoes National Park. So first up, Ken, if you can hop on screen, we'll highlight you and we can start a briefing.
Aloha, everybody. So this morning, the latest information about the lava flow is that we have one principal lava flow that is being fed from fissure 3 up on Mauna Loa's northeast rift zone. This lava flow has now reached the bottom of the steep part of Mauna Loa and is moving into the flatter saddle area. So yesterday it crossed the Mauna Loa Observatory Road. Last night it crossed the dirt Hilo to Kona Road, which doesn't really go from Hilo to Kona, but crossed that road, and it's on the flat ground now. It appears the lava flow is beginning to spread out some, and we expect it to slow down. Last night it was moving around, our calculations for last night, it was moving around 130 meters an hour. And it's about 3.6 miles from the Daniel K. Inouye Saddle Road right now. If it continues at that rate, the soonest it would get to the Saddle Road is approximately 2 days from this point. We expect it will probably take longer than that. As the lava flow spreads out, it'll probably interfere with its own progress. And we expect it to slow down some from that previous rate. So we're looking at about 2 days out at the earliest that it might actually hit the Saddle Road at this point. There are also fissure 4, which is slightly lower on the northeast rift zone, has declined in productivity overnight. It is feeding two smaller fingers that have come over the northeast rift zone. Those are starting to slow down as well, so that we don't expect them to advance a lot further than they are, and they're much smaller than the principal flow. Overnight, the seismicity quieted significantly on the northeast rift zone. This seismicity, we believe that the drop in seismicity probably indicates that the dike is less likely to continue to propagate down the rift zone and open up new fissures. That's still a possibility, but it's just a lower probability possibility at this point. So the dominant seismic noise now is tremor, which is the lava exiting the vent at the fissure zone vibrates a lot as gas bubbles are released. So that's what we're mostly seeing on our seismometers today. It continues to emit significant amounts of volcanic gas, mostly SO2, and Pele's hair. We have reports from Pele's hair falling at several places in the saddle area. These are the shorter, stubbier, very kind of sharp pieces of Pele's hair. So we know that there is glass particulate being carried at least for some distance, and so that's quite a bit of distance, actually, somewhere between 5 and 10 miles from the vent. We're seeing fallout of Paley's Hair along with the gas. The south winds have kind of abated, and we've got fairly still air on the island today, so the plume is rising kind of directly over the vents. So that is pretty much the summary for this morning. Thanks.
All right, thank you, Ken. Next up, we have Talmadge, and I do want to apologize for the typo for your notice that I put out this morning. I did a correction after, so, oh wait, I put you guys back on to share.
Good morning.
All right,
good morning. Sir. I'm Talmadge Magnus, Civil Defense Administrator for County of Hawaii. Our update today, you know, stems from several operations. As the lava gets closer to DKI Highway, many of our partners are doing their plans because that is the main transit between East and West Hawaii. So, you know, the fallback is basically the coastal routes that have been in existence for all these years. So, you know, everybody's operations are going to have to roll back to that kind of route using. And the other big operation that we're facing is the thousands of visitors, or the thousands of residents and visitors that are flocking to the DKI and the eruption site to view this current Mauna Loa eruption. It's creating a safety hazard environment on the highway, which is, you know, for Hawaii standards, a high-speed highway, 60 miles an hour. Everybody travels a lot faster than that on that road, and, you know, big tractor trailer traffic as well. So we're dealing with that, working with Pualkaloa training area to perhaps put in a viewing area where that can handle all these people and their vehicles. And, you know, at this point, no other communities are threatened. So that planning aspect continues. Our messaging to the folks, you know, as far as preparation, and just working with HVO as far as timing for the DKI possible inundation. That's all, Steve.
Perfect. That off. That's lighting. Well, thank you, Talmadge. Thank you, Ken. Next up, Jessica Farrakane from Hawaii Volcanoes National Park. Do you have some briefing for us?
Hey, good morning, everybody. I just have three brief updates to share this morning. Number one is just correcting some misinformation I've seen out there. The park is open. Most of the park that the regular visitors go to is open. Mauna Loa itself is closed, as well as Mauna Loa Road. So just to make sure everybody is aware of that information. And the park is open 24 hours a day. I did want to add a safety message. We are currently in healthy air conditions, but there was definitely some increased fog at my house in Mountain View this morning, and you could see some fog and haze in the air. So just be sure that you're aware of air quality, or visitors are aware of air quality when they come into the park. If air is bad, move to an area where the air is better. The park is huge. It's almost the size of Oahu. There's always usually a place in the park that you can find that has clean air. And the other safety message I have today is driving safety. Keep your eyes on the road and your hands on the wheel, like the old song goes. People are very distracted right now. In the park, you can see both eruptions, Kilauea as well as Mauna Loa, the Fissure 4. I had reports that you could see that again this morning under darkness. So please just drive safely when you're in the park. Encourage your readers to do so if you're covering this. And lastly, the park put up a new web page. It's been updated. It's a Kilauea and Mauna Loa eruption page. It has safety information, the air quality alert I just mentioned with a map. It also has public domain photo gallery of Mauna Loa images and Kilauea images, and links to the new USGS webcams and their alerts as well. If anybody would like to be added to the park's news release list, I will put my email address in the chat, and you can send me a note, and I will add you to our distribution list. That's it for me. Thank you.
I'll go through all that. Thank you, Jessica. not sure if we're going to have any other briefing for other folks, so let's move on to questions. First up, I see Jonathan. You raised your hand first. Who's your question for?
Yeah, guys, this is for Ken Han, and I'm hearing 2 days. You say 2 days it could possibly reach Saddle Road. I know we don't like to talk about how likely that is, but I got to ask the question, how likely is that? And if you just go into more detail of explaining what is happening as the lava enters that flat area. I know it's spreading. It hits flat and then spreads. So double question there, but most importantly, I think everyone wants to know the likelihood of it reaching the road.
Well,
we don't know the likelihood, but
yeah, I mean, the likelihood of it reaching the road, it's very high probability that this lava flow, if it continues, will definitely reach the road, right? It's just a question of timing. And so the timing I get is not that it's going to hit in 2 days, but that that is the fastest time as of right now that it could get to cover the road. We expect it to meander a fair amount out in there, to spread out. It also might inflate once it gets on the flat road, on the flat ground, and store a lot of lava inside of it. That's a kind of a typical behavior even for AA flows. So there's a lot of things that could change when it arrives and where it arrives. So it can, you know, if it spreads out, it can interfere with its own progress and get kind of caught in corners and fill areas in. So it's kind of a volume problem. You're pouring a lot of material out into an area, and we don't know exactly how that's going to occur. We don't have a really good handle on the fundamental properties of this particular flow just yet in terms of viscosity and that kind of thing. So, you know, in terms of how it's likely to behave when it rolls out on that flat ground, we're just going to wait and watch and see what it's doing. So 2 days, don't take it as 2 days. It's going to close the road in 2 days, but that's the fastest that it'll get to the road.
Okay. Thank you, Jonathan. Thank you, Ken. Mike, you're up next.
Okay, dokie. This one would be for Talmadge. A couple questions regarding DKI. How close would the lava have to get to DKI before you decide to close the highway?
It's actually more a matter of time. State highways, as Toby, they need at least 6 hours to activate. Even though they've got everything planned and in place, it'll take them 6 hours to shut things down. And HVO has their processes. They assured me that I'll get plenty of notice. So it's more a matter of time.
Okay. And if I can follow up, is there any plan to divert the lava from the highway? Is it possible to do anything like that?
We were having that discussion this morning. Nothing solid came out of it. And yeah, we'll continue to have that discussion. But at this time, no plans.
Thank you, Mike. Thank you, Talmadge. I'll do one more on our list here, and then I'll check our phone call in. Jennifer, do you have a question?
Hi. This question would be for anyone who has any thoughts or is willing to answer. And I don't know if there are any Native Hawaiians who are speaking, but I want to know what you would like folks to keep in mind as they flock to the flow in terms of Hawaiian culture and in terms of, you know, folks who might be, you know, praying or chanting or conducting ceremony right now. I know Jessica mentioned yesterday about the sacredness of what's happening, so I just, you know, wanted to hear your thoughts on what, you know, the broader public should keep in mind in terms of their...
I don't know if it's just on my end, but the camera froze, and we lost some of the audio there. Do we have anybody who would be able to answer those questions? Ken, Talmadge, Jessica?
Jennifer specifically asked for somebody who is Native Hawaiian, so I will defer to any Native Hawaiians on the call.
Do we have anybody on the call who can answer that?
I mean, I think the main thing is that within the park, within our field crews, within civil defense, we all really want to push the message that people should be respectful. This is a place with a culture. It is not just a place of entertainment. So I think everybody visiting should, you know, try and keep that in mind, that respect is a really important thing when you see this. It's a really fascinating and really amazing natural phenomena that we're seeing, but it has a lot deeper meaning to a lot of the people on the island.
Thank you, Jennifer. Thank you, Ken. Before we move on to Chris, looking at the phone call-in, we have a area code 310. Do you have any questions? You need to unmute if you're going to ask. If not, we have an 808-212 number. Do you have any questions for our presenters? Nothing there. Moving down, 808-295. Do you have any questions? Hearing silence, I'll tap our last call in, 808-960. Do you have any questions? Yeah, well, thank you very much for those. Moving to the top of our chat list here, we have Tim Hurley. Do you have a question? And for who?
Yes, I have a question for Talmadge. Can you characterize the importance of the highway to Big Island traffic circulation? What would be the difference in commuting time from Hilo to Kona?
I'm not sure if you live on island, but you know, historically, before DKI was put in, the old Saddle Road was, you know, pretty difficult to traverse, definitely with the larger vehicles. And so now that it's in, it's become the main transit between East and West Hawaii. So it's very important. You know, cut down on time. It's a beautiful drive as well, but you know, a lot of commuters as well as the heavy traffic for government, for industry, you know, is using that road. Losing that part of infrastructure will mean that we fall back to the coastal routes, Highway 19 and Highway 11, and you know, traffic. Ever since DKI came into place, population's grown, and a lot more traffic on the road. So those communities, Hamakua, Waimea, they're going to be seeing an increase in traffic, and you know, it's just going to cause congested areas to get more congested, which equates to safety as well, safety issues. So multiple impacts when we lose DKI, if we lose it. And as far as timing, you know, in the past, Hilo to Kona, you know, 2.5 hours. Via Hamakua, and so it's going to be a little bit different because you're going to have a lot more traffic, and so it's going to be 2.5+ hours to go that distance.
Okay, thank you, Ken. Thank you, Tim. Next up, Diane.
Okay. Question? Oh. Yeah, sorry. I wrote my question in the chat as well. Kind of riffing off the other reporter's questions. So I actually haven't driven DKI for a while. How long does it take? Talmadge just said it would be 2.5 hours plus going the Hamakua route, but how long is it to go on DKI? My other questions were, how do you divert lava? Where would the viewing area be set up? How long would it take until it's up? And if it closes DKI, would the county rebuild over the flow or around it to create another east-west road? How long would it take? Sorry, I get plenty of questions.
Yeah, let me see if I remember them all. Let's see. Yeah, of course, DKI is very important. It is a state highway, I believe, under federal funding. So, and if that's taken out, they have their process. So, you know, they have, well, first thing we know, the lava will have to stop, the flow, the eruption will have to stop before anything's put in. So that process will take place. You know, comparing, looking at 2018, how quick they were able to put in some of that critical infrastructure, definitely the main routes, you know, they were put in very, very fast. I can't think of the time frame, but it was within months after the flow stopped. So that process will start immediately. You know, the state highways guys, they're looking at that already. Yeah, I can't forget the rest of your questions.
So it looks like your guys' computer may have to do a reboot here in the middle of the conference call. Got to love technology. So if you guys drop off, if you can
possibly, on our end?
On your end, yeah. So okay. If you guys can possibly hop back on after, we'll keep going until you guys get cut off. Next up.
I can handle the lava diversion question.
Oh, sure.
As well. Lava diversion is a tricky thing to do, right, especially on flat ground, and it really comes down to a volume problem. And what we're seeing right now is that take 10 of the biggest dump trucks you can think of, we're getting that many dump trucks of lava every second delivered by this lava flow. So if you think you can pile up stuff in front of it faster than it can deliver stuff, you're probably wrong. And so, you know, it'd be very hard to really effectively stop the lava from filling in the area that it's going to fill in. It's just not an easy problem to solve.
Okay, then where's the viewing area?
So if you're familiar with the portion of the old saddle road that traversed from Pu'uhuluhulu to Mauna Kea State Park, which it used to be back then, but now is the Kahele Park. That section kind of cross some older flows, some rough a'a flows, and then kind of made it back through the vegetation back to the Mauna Kea State Park. That section within Pua'akaloa training area is what we're working on as a one-way route from that intersection across Kahele Park to come out, travel back towards Pu'uhuluhulu, which affords some very spectacular views of the flow as it comes off Mauna Loa's northeast flank and then pools in the plains below. And that's what we're looking at, trying to work out all the logistical issues. Traffic has been very, very, busy up there. Jessica knows because the park would deal with that every night, you know, during that period of sunset to, you know, a couple hours after sunset. But yeah, we're trying to work with the Army and the other landowners in that area to get this to happen, just to relieve the issues on DKI for safety purposes.
Thank you very much. Looks like you guys haven't dropped off, which is great. Got a couple more questions here for the last few minutes. Jonathan, do you have another question?
Yeah, I have two here. So is the Pu'uhuluhulu training area at risk at all? Are we seeing any danger in the site for that area? And then I have a follow-up to that.
But they might have done the reboot because I have a frozen screen for Ken, so I will stop spotlighting that. Do we have anyone else on the call from the county or who might be able to answer that question? Okay, sorry, Jonathan, we might have to wait until they get back on. We still have Jessica. Does anybody have questions for Park Service?
I could ask Jessica a quick question. Just talking about actual numbers of volume of visitors, what do you see in there?
Right now, it has been remarkably light visitation, and this is a normal lull between Thanksgiving and maybe about next week annually before our big holiday season starts to kick in. We expect, as the news that you can see both eruptions from the park, Kilauea and Mauna Loa, as that gets out through social media, etc., that visitation will start to increase. And of course, if lava reaches Saddle Road, we are expecting a double influx of visitation in addition to our normal holiday increase in visitors.
Thank you very much. I do see that Wendy had commented in the chat that we do have another representative from the USGS. So if there's questions about the geology of it, we do have someone else who can help. Jonathan, I'm going to save you for when Ken gets back. And move along. Nathan, do you have a question that either Jessica or possibly Wendy might be able to answer?
Sorry, my question's more for Tom Edge and Ken.
Okay. What about you, Stephanie?
Actually, I have a question for Jessica. You talked a little bit about traffic to the park. How does that differ from really kind of what you saw in the 2018 eruption and also from what you saw when Kilauea began erupting last year again?
Yeah, so it's different from the 2018 eruption, Stephanie, in that the 2018 eruption was Pu'u'o'o and Halemaumau. So we had one volcano with two eruption sites, both of which were viewed or accessed from within the park. The flows from Mauna Loa now, the ones that are headed towards the saddle, those have flowed outside of the park, and there's a lot of really good viewing on other parts of the island right now. So not everybody is bottlenecked, so to speak, into Hawaii Volcanoes National Park at this time. Does that make sense, that answer?
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you very much. Lower your hand. Chris Leonard, a question that maybe Jessica or Wendy can answer.
Perhaps
Steve,
somebody from you.
Ken. We're back online, just so you know.
Okay, two questions. One, as the lava hits the flats at the bottom of the Mauna Loa slope, is there any guidance on what the slope structure is east or west from there? As it pools at the base, that it goes west, it goes east? And then the second question is regarding flight restrictions over the mountain. What's in place at this point?
I guess I'll handle the lava and Jessica can handle the flight restriction part, I think. So right now, the lava is coming down pretty close to the track of the 1935 flow, which is pretty close to the divide between heading west and east. It's in the eastern side of the drainage system right now. But because of the unknowns related to exactly how it might propagate across the flats, say it comes across and goes slightly to the east and builds up the thing, and then the channel breaks out a little bit upslope and then forms another flow, it's possible the flow itself could push itself into the other drainage. So there's a lot of unknowns in here about how that flow is going to move across that flat area. So until we see it, we won't know, but right now it's in the eastern-facing drainage.
Yeah, and I typed the answer. It was straight from the news release the park put out on Monday as far as the TFR, or the temporary flight restriction, and that was enacted by the FAA on Monday. It's currently a 5 nautical mile radius around the summit of the Mauna and 5,000 feet above ground level. We do expect that to decrease a little bit in its scope and be kind of relocated in the days ahead.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. And going back to the top of the list here, Nathan, now that we have everyone back online.
Yeah, this question's for Ken or Tomage. I'm just wondering, do you guys have an idea if it does cross Saddle, where it will cross? Is there like an area? I know it's puddling and it'll spread out, but is there like an area that you're keeping an eye on?
Well, there's a rather large area that we're keeping an eye on because it's, again, going across a very flat area. And it's going to cross someplace to the west of Pu'uhuluhulu. Exactly where, we don't know. And then probably be funneled down. It looks like right now, if it follows the track it's on without interfering with itself, it'll probably come around the north side of Pu'uhuluhulu, which is right at the Mauna Kea turnoff on the saddle road. So, but again, you know, it's really uncertain. Our projections are assuming that there's no interference with the flow, and, you know, that's not necessarily a good assumption.
Okay, thank you very much. Tim, did we answer your question yet?
I have another question. Ken mentioned a road that was passed over last night. And is that road still in use? And what's the importance of that road?
The importance of that road is that it's a geographical marker. No, it's not in use, and there's a big gate on it because it goes into the Pohakaloa training area, and nobody can pass through that. So the bulk of that road actually lies within the Pohakaloa training area grounds.
Does anyone use it?
The military uses it over there, and it's occasionally used on the other side, but it doesn't go anywhere.
Okay.
Thank you very much. Looks like we've got three more questions, and then we can finish up. Catherine, we have a question for him.
Hi, thanks. First of all, thanks to all of you for taking the time to do this. And I know you guys have spent a lot of hours talking with media, so thank you for doing that. My question, and I'm sorry if I missed this, if it was already addressed, but maybe more for Jessica, is I want to know right now, where are the best viewing areas within the park for visitors who want to come and see it? Where you folks would recommend people go in and outside the park that's safe, that's not going to cause an accident on Saddle Road?
Sure. Yeah. When you have a chance, if you click that link, I put a little bit higher up that eruption viewing page that has an exceptional recap of all the eruption viewing areas right now along mostly around the Kilauea caldera that afford views of both Kilauea and Mauna Loa. Two of the best ones that I've been to quite a bit in the last few days have been Kupina'ipali, which is about a half mile walk from the Kilauea Visitor Center. That one gives you a good direct view right into the Halima'uma'u Lava Lake, which is about 2 miles in the distance. And it also gives you a shot right up to Mauna Loa. Actually, this photo taken yesterday, some of you were on the call, that's Kilauea on my right side, and that is Mauna Loa Fissure 4 on the left. That was yesterday, so who knows what Mauna Loa Pele are going to decide to do overnight, but that was the best viewing. And also the Volcano House, the caldera side of the Volcano House Hotel, right across the street from the Visitor Center is another good spot, as well as Kilauea Overlook. But that link will give you detailed information, miles, etc., where to park.
Great. Thank you very much, Jessica. Damon, final three questions. Damon, do you have a question? Are you available? Okay, we'll skip over you for now. And Jonathan, your follow-up.
Yeah, I'm still curious about the Pohakuloa training area. Is it in danger? And then I have two quick questions that I think we really need to get to about Saddle Road, but I want that answer first, please.
If no one's on from PTA, Jonathan, I did drop the link to Amy Phillips. She is PTA's current PIO. Ken probably can answer this, but if you wanted it straight from PTA, her email address is in the chat.
Hi there, Josh. This is Amy. Do you hear me?
Yes.
Sorry, it was just lots of technical difficulties, but I am here. But PTA is fine. There's no danger to anybody working here on post. And, you know, we're just preparing like we would during any emergencies. We're making plans. We're taking accountability
He said no danger to people. We were just hearing about that road that leads to the facility. Any property in damage there?
No.
Or in danger there? All right, so Saddle Road, real quickly, Guy, and I don't mean to monopolize this, but I think it's really important and what people want to know about. And I know, Tom H., you had mentioned there's discussions of diversion, and I just instantly went back to that historical moment when General Patton dropped the bombs on the lava flow. It allegedly didn't work. What are plans of diversion? What would be those options, and when would you pull the trigger on those?
As I said earlier, discussion has only started this morning, and so there's no definite plan to do diversion. You know, past examples did not work, and let's see. We are going to be getting information from USGS as far as scenarios where there was success in diversions, you know, around the globe. We'll take a look at those, but right now we don't have any definite plans, mechanisms, or timing to do any diversions.
And you had mentioned safety earlier, and I was just wondering, are emergency facilities preparing for more like helicopter flights to transport patients, things like that from side to side? Or has there been any discussion about that? Because I can only imagine that's going to increase transport times for health reasons as well.
Well, aviation of EMS folks, it's always on their minds with critical patients. But we are in discussion with both Hilo Medical Center and Kona Community Hospital with their plans. Also engaged with state emergency management as far as, what the medical corps and state assets can provide support for the medical facilities on the island.
Got you. Thanks, guys. And Ken Han, if you could real quickly, what are some examples of diversion working? Do you believe in that?
Oops. Well, it depends on what you mean by working. again, it's a volume problem. You know, you're going to store up a certain amount of lava somehow, right? And the places that they've had some success are mainly in Italy, where they've done a fair amount of work on this. You need a very geographically constricted area if you're going to dam the lava up, but it's just like damming water. And they were able to successfully dam it up for a few months, but eventually overflowed the dams. The other way is to try and get it to stay near the source and distribute itself. But nobody's really had a lot of success with that. And breaking down the channels is extremely difficult to do. They've had some luck doing that. Bombing to date has really had very little impact, particularly on flows like the ones we're seeing today. So, and then there is a lot of issues here as well with what's an appropriate thing to do or not inappropriate thing to do. So it's a very difficult process at any rate, especially with high volume flows like this.
Well, thank you, Jonathan, and I apologize, I have leaf blowers going past my window. I want to get to Michael, but before we do, I want to be respectful of our speaker's time. Ken, Talmadge, Jessica, we're a little bit past about 9:30 time. We're at 9:40. Do you guys have a few more minutes to answer these last few questions? If not, I'd like to finish with Michael, and then Tim, Diane, and Damon. Well, we can follow up with you guys at a different point. So how's our schedule going for our presenters?
I have about 5-10 more minutes, Max.
Yeah. How about Ken and Talmadge? How are you guys doing for schedule? I know you guys are busy.
Yeah, I have
about the same.
Yeah, not very much time. We have another meeting at 10, so that we have to prepare for. So we're running out of time here.
Well, let's see what Mike. What question do you have? And then we'll see if we have time to address the other folks.
Super quick question for Talmadge and Ken. You currently have on the books a community Facebook Live for tomorrow evening that was set before the eruption started. Are you still planning to have that meeting?
Yes, I think it's necessary to go forth with that meeting.
Thank you.
Very much. Sorry for the awkwardness for the sounds. Tim, do you have is your question quick, or do you have a bunch of follow-up?
Yes. Ken, you mentioned that seismicity had quieted down last night, and I was wondering, is that a good sign? Is that a possible beginning of the end for this?
No, it has nothing to do with the end of the eruption. It just means that the conduits established, they're open and free-flowing, and so we're no longer, the magma's no longer having to push the rock apart to get out to the surface. So that's all it means, and it means that if it is attempting to move further down rift, it's doing it rather quietly, which happens on occasion too, but no, it has nothing to do with the end of the eruption at all. All of our eruptions, the seismicity is highest just before the eruption, because rock is breaking for the lava to make it to the surface, and then it quiets down once the eruption is established.
Okay. Thank you very much. If we're hopefully get these next two in, Diane, do you have a quick follow-up?
Yeah, it was in the chat as well. So to Jonathan's question, what kind of emergencies are you preparing for? You've talked about driving safety and breathing issues. Is it that? And to whatever Ken said, are there cultural protocols that would make any kinds of diversions inappropriate?
So I'm not real sure about what you're asking as far as other emergencies. You know, the planning is going on for possible, you know, inundations to other areas, and so, you know, that's one aspect of emergency planning that we're doing aside from the fog and what the safety for the folks up viewing lava at this point.
Sorry, Diane, I muted to get some feedback there. And then let's finish strong with our last question from Damon. What do you think?
Yes. If the lava crosses over Saddle Road, will the county still be allowing access to the mountain from both ends of the highway, or will you be blocking off the highways?
So the plan at this point, and the plan has changed a couple times already, but on the Hilo side, the closure will be about mile 8, the junction of Palmana, Old Saddle, and DKI, and the other will be up at Kahele Park. So the discussion is, because there still will be, you know, a demand or a demand for visitation or viewing, that any kind of viewing area that we put in PTA on the Old Saddle section, that'll still be used. And of course, this is all contingent on that area still being safe. Discussion consideration for continued viewing if DKI is taken out is considered.
Thank you.
Thank you. So, with that, that concludes today's press conference. Mahalo. Thank you for participating. We do tentatively have another briefing scheduled for tomorrow, same time, 9 a.m., same login information, at least for the remainder of this week. If you would like to be on our distribution list for updates or notifications or media advisories, and you're not already there, please email us at volcanomedia@usgs.gov. Other than that, do any of our speakers have any closing comments? Or are we good to go?
I think we'd just like to thank everybody for participating and helping us get information to the public. We really appreciate it.
All right. Well, thank you, everybody. And until tomorrow, have a good day.
Thanks.